How are you guys doing? Today's Wednesday. Yay, it's the middle of the week. And so I'm feeling in the mood to podcast, so I'm going to podcast. Plus my yarn delivery was delayed 2 days because of the snow that we had. And by snow, I mean we had really heavy, wet snow, then covered in rain, which now has made a sheet of ice. So this blizzard that we had in New England this week was just kind of not really a blizzard, but left a few inches of really heavy and wet snow on the ground. So anyway, I can't dye yarn right now, so what am I gonna do? I'm gonna podcast. That's what I'm gonna do. So hey guys, welcome back to my channel. I've had a ton of new subscribers, and I feel like all of you guys are coming over from Mina's channel, so I just want to say hello and welcome. I also had a shout out on KT's channel on Inside Number 23 on her last podcast, so I also want to welcome anyone who's come from there as well. I hope you guys enjoy. This is a podcast about crocheting and knitting, some spinning sometimes, mostly yarn dyeing, and pretty much all the crafty things that I'm getting up to lately. I am Kayleen and I'm your host, and I am the principal fiber artist and yarn dyer behind Littlebean Crochet on Etsy and littlebeanlovesyarn.com. You can find me on social media. As always, I put social media information on the screen. I usually put relevant information on the screen, and then down below the video you'll see a few things. If you're not subscribed and you'd like to be, there's a subscribe button. There's a small bell that will give you a notification every time I upload a new video. There's also a like and dislike button, so if you like what you're seeing, you're always welcome to like the video. And then there's also timestamps and relevant pattern links or website links or other information in the description box. So anyway, welcome. I hope you enjoy. Today's Wednesday again. We just had snow again, and we're gonna get snow again on Saturday. how fun. So I'll do a small introduction, I suppose, since I have a ton of new people who have just come on over to my channel. Aside from being a fiber artist, a yarn dyer, all of that, I am a mom of two kids. I have two small toddlers. Cecilia is 3.5 and Tucker is 1.5. Cece goes to school a few days a week, so I usually get some good time in either for filming a podcast, making sure I get all my yarn dyeing done, my packages sent out, things like that, and then Tucker's home with me all day. I have a husband who I live with. We used to have a cat also, but unfortunately my son is allergic, so we had to rehome our cat with his grandmother. I am in my early 30s. I won't give you the exact number, but I've been crocheting since I was around 13 years old, so right around 20 years, and I've been knitting on and off through my entire life, but I've only recently picked it up and found a love for knitting this past year, which has been fun. And I also started yarn dyeing this past year, so that's also been really fun. Things are going great. I'm enjoying this podcast a lot. I love sharing the things that I'm doing with you guys and sharing little life bits and other stuff like that, I guess. So the room you see me in, if you've never been here before, this is my spare room slash office slash guest room. A few episodes back I did a little bit of tour of the room. I think it was called The Grand Tour. That was the episode where I had redone this room just after the new year, because it was really cluttered since we had moved in. It wasn't really suiting our needs, but now it is. So we have desk and all the fiber tools everywhere. You'll see my sock machine behind me. I have a warping mill. I have all of my yarn. My bare yarn is over here. We have two nice windows here to give me some light. So usually you'll see me filming in here. Sometimes you'll see me filming in my living room. If Cecilia's at school, I like to sit in the living room and film because it has better light than this room. But she's not at school right now, so we're gonna work with what we have. So today I don't have a ton of things to talk about in terms of yarn dyeing because, again, my yarn isn't here. I was expecting it today and I was going to do some dyeing today and then share that on the podcast later this week, but my yarn's not going to arrive until Friday, and it was supposed to be here today, so it's a bit of a bummer. I do have things to work on, but I can do this as well. In terms of crocheting and knitting, I do have some finished objects and works in progress to talk about, so if that's what you're interested in, then just sit tight and I'll get into those things. Okay, so as most of you guys know, and many of you can see here, I do have a circular sock machine that I use to make socks. I do hand knit socks. I did I finished my first pair of hand knit socks on a couple weeks ago. I think it was a few weeks ago that I finished my socks, but I just wore them for the first time this week. They were so comfortable and wonderful. They took me a very long time to finish, but I definitely prefer hand knitting two at a time because I definitely am the one sock and done type kind of person. So if you haven't seen those socks yet, there's a podcast called Finishing Things, and there's the thumbnail is me holding up those socks where I talk all about them and how I did them and the techniques I used. But I have been knitting a bit on the sock machine because I like to use the machine to make sample socks and swatches for my yarn to help me visualize how the yarn is looking, like what it's going to look like most batches, and also to help you guys visualize what it looks like, because sometimes it's hard to do so in a skein, especially if a skein hasn't been rewound on itself. So yeah, I haven't had a huge chunk of time to be able to dedicate to knitting socks, just because, again, I'm a mom of two and I'm running a small business and I'm home all day and I'm just busy all the time. But I am setting some time aside during the week to kind of explore my sock machine, the things that I can do with it, the amount of time it takes me to do things, and such. So I want to show you a half object. This is a sock that I knit up on the machine this week, or this past week. So it's getting slightly blown out because the light, again, the lighting in here is really direct. But this is a sock that I did. This is a 60 stitch sock. The cylinder is 60 stitches, and I did a 1x3 ribbing for the cuff, the leg and the cuff. I did a regular short row decreases for the heel and also for the toe. So this sock was done toe up on the machine. So I began stitching my toe, and then I hung my toe across the entire machine, which means I have to learn about tension. This sock has done very well in terms of tension. You can't even see the seam that is in here. So you can see here where there are two stitches sharing. That row is the seam. So I was able to successfully, for the first time in all of my time knitting on this sock machine, to successfully hang a toe without tension problems and without having dropped stitches in my toe, which was really awesome. So I was proud of myself for that. And then I switched colors. So this yarn is yarn that was dyed by Sheena over at Casual Fashion Queen. If you've been here for a little while, you've seen that Little Mermaid bag that I use for socks and other one skein projects. That was the Mermaid's Dream, and this was the yarn that came with the bag. So I bought a kit from her, and it came with this beautiful reddish purple black variegated skein and this yellow mini for heels, toes, and cuffs. This was about 23 grams, and this was 100 gram skein. So it was enough for me to do this has a significant amount left, and I did a heel and toe and a 10 row cuff with it. So I'm very pleased with that. I had some drop stitches, and I can show you kind of where they were. So when I put the ribber on the machine, you can see here that the ridge of purl stitches goes very low here, and the rest of the purl stitches end here. So I had a drop stitch that I had to repair on that side, and then I also had a drop stitch that I had to repair on this side, also when I attached the ribber. So you can see here there's a small line across. That was the stitch that was dropped, so I had to knit it all the way up the cuff. I did, I think, two or three rows past where I hung my toe using the toe yarn, and then I switched over to the main colorway for 55 rows, and then I did my short row heel where you are only working on one half of the needles. So I work, if you've seen me working on the sock machine before, I'll try and insert, I don't know if I'll be able to insert some footage, but I will definitely link you to, oh, it's up here. I will definitely link you to my demo that I did on this machine. But on the back half of the machine, the machine piece of the machine that's farthest away from me, is where I begin my toe, and then I hang it to the front of the machine, which is closest to me. And then when I work to my heel, I work my heel on the part of the machine that's closest to me, so that the seam goes on the back part of the sock. So where I hang my toe and the seam is, or even if I just did a regular toe and then I kitchen nerd the toe after, it would be on the bottom part of the sock. So this part of the sock is knit on the machine that's farthest away from me, and then the bottom part of the sock is the part of the sock that's closest to me. For those who are interested, I don't know how many of you guys are interested in that, but anyway, I worked the short row heel, which is worked on half of the needles, back and forth, decreasing and increasing. These aren't wraps, they are just regular decrease. So on a sock machine, you're doing one needle up to wrap the stitch and two needles down on the opposite side to knit. So you are doing one up, two down, alternating sides each time you crank across your sock. And then I did three rows of plain stockinette between my ending of my heel and the beginning of my ribbing. So on a circular sock machine, you have to put a ribber on top of the machine, transfer all of your stitches onto the ribber. So I did a 3x1, so every fourth stitch was put onto my ribber. And then I did 40 rows of 3x1 ribbing with the main color, and then 10 extra rows for a colorful cuff on the same thing, on the ribbing, 3x1. You can see it better inside. There's the 3x1 rib. And then I cast off on waste yarn, and then to finish my sock, I did a crochet, single crochet around the entire top of the sock to finish it off. Now it does flare, but when you have it on your leg, it doesn't really make a difference. It's extremely stretchy, has a lot of give. Now, to speak in terms of fit for me, normally I do a 60 stitch sock when I hand knit a sock, but my gauge is tighter than this machine. I have a very tight gauge when it comes to sock knitting, I'm finding at least. So this actually fits my husband's foot. Now he is a size 9.5 to 10 men's, but he's like a quadruple E. He's very, very wide, flat feet. And these fit him very well. For me, they are wide. They're more loosely fitting than my hand knit or hand stitched socks, because this is still hand knit. I'm hand cranking a sock, but my hand knit sock is tighter than this. The cuff, even though it's a 3x1 rib, still doesn't feel as tight as I'd like it to be. Now, in terms of commercial socks, I'm a person who is very much of the adage of like, tighter the better. I really like tight, tight socks on my feet. I'm not a super fan of socks that feel loose or feel like they're gonna fall off. And I know that knit socks feel differently in terms of fit as opposed to commercially knit socks. Also because there's no elastane or any other elastic properties to this aside from just the memory of the wool. So I know that it's not going to be feeling the same as a commercially knit sock, but I do like it to be a little bit tighter. So what I may do, because the ribbers that I have are for, or the cylinders and ribbers, I have a 60 stitch cylinder, and then I have a 54 stitch, I mean I have a 72 stitch cylinder, but I think I might see if I can return my 72 stitch cylinder and get a 54 stitch cylinder instead, because I did not think that I was going to use a smaller size, but I may. I still have to play with tension. Again, I'm not a professional sock knitter or a machine sock knitter. I'm still learning everything. That's why I'm doing this podcast, because I want to share it with you. But this is the sock that I knit. It took me all of Pretty Woman to knit. I was watching Pretty Woman, or had it on in the room while Tucker was napping. And it took me the duration of the movie to knit this sock from cast on to finishing. Now it's not finished all the way. I do have ends that are not woven in inside the sock as well. But in terms of the structure, it's not going to unravel. All the ends are knotted, kind of woven in, but not really blocked or taken care of in any other way. Okay, so that's what I have for half object. I have two more works in progress that I'm going to share with you, and then I'll talk about another finished object that I don't have here, but that was for the baby shower I went to on this past Sunday. Okay, so for the two works in progress that I have, they're both crochet works. I've done a small amount of progress on my crochet rabbit hole, my crochet granny stripe blanket. I finished one extra row, so I'm going to show you because I haven't worked on this in so long. But this is my crochet granny stripe blanket. For those who are new, this is knit out or crocheted out of mostly Once Upon a Corgi yarns. So I have two, the green and the white are potluck colors, which are, you know, one of a kind colors from Hedgehog Fibers in their skinny singles. This is Like My Cold Dead Heart, Dark Like My Soul, and then Demon Unicorn from Once Upon a Corgi. So I'm doing it in a way that's kind of like stained glass. I'm not doing random mini skeins because I don't have enough mini skeins to do a granny stripe blanket, but I did finish a row and then I made it about halfway. You can see my stitch right there. That's the last stitch I did. It's about halfway through this black row, dark blue row. That's the only progress I've done on that. My goal is to really kind of pick this up more. My time is limited, so this is always my last resort when I'm looking at projects. I've had so many like new ideas and things that I'm working on that I find myself distracted and pulled in a bunch of different directions, but this project is still hanging out. I'm still going to be working on this. Slowly but surely, I will tick away on it, but it is still there. It is just in a very big duffel. I got this duffel at Target. It's kind of like a canvasy, like waterproof feeling material, and it is by, here it is, Lada Jan's Daughter. This is just a line of bags. I think they're marketed as travel bags. I have my crochet stitch Bible in the pocket because this is the bag that I take to teach crochet. I teach crochet Saturdays at Marblehead Knits, which is my local yarn shop. But that blanket's living in this bag. There's plenty of room in this bag. And that's all I have to say about that, really. Okay, and then my other work in progress is in this bag. I just started this yesterday during the snowstorm because when snow falls, you're supposed to cast on things, right? So that's what I did. I used my own hand-dyed yarn. This is Elder Tree. This is a brown and green colorway. It's a very earthy feeling colorway. It makes me feel like tree bark. But this is one of my tree series, so if you are new here or you've never seen any of my hand-dyed yarn, there are three trees that I did from the Harry Potter universe so far. I did Wigan Tree, which is a rare type of tree. It's not really common or talked about too much, but it is a magical tree. Its bark's used for the Wiganwald potion. I think the Wigan Tree, I don't know what type of tree it is. I don't know if it's a rowan tree, but anyway. So that is kind of like fall colors, really red, brown, green, kind of all blended together. And there's Wampy Willow, which is more of like a fall foliage type feeling, where it's a really warm brown with orange and green and yellow. And then there's Elder Tree, which is more muted browns and like light and dark browns, and then greens of different values. So I cast on the Simple Scallops Shawl by Christy Ashmore. I think I messed up her name last time I talked about this pattern, but it is a lace crochet shawl and it kind of looks like camo, like camouflage, but it's a very earthy feeling shawl. I would say, I don't know how far I am, probably just about halfway. I'm not quite to the halfway mark yet in terms of using all my yarn, but I'm just going to continue until I finish. It doesn't look like much now, but the magic happens when you block it out. So you get all of this wonderful lace detailing. If I can do this, here we go. So you see what the patterning looks like. It's very pretty. So that's what it will look like when it's finished, when it's all blocked out. But for now, it's very scrunched up. I'm using a fingering weight yarn. This is on my everyday sock base, which is a 75-25 superwash merino nylon blend. And I am using a J hook. My preferred hook is Boy brand. Yeah, it's just a J size, US size 10 or a 6mm hook. So that when you block it out, you have a nice drape and the lace will open up appropriately. Okay, so that is that. Okay. So in terms of finished objects, the only finished object that I have to talk about, I don't have with me. I was working on a hat last week. I didn't finish it. I couldn't find my other needle. So I only have a small circular set of needles. I was working on a child size hat, you know, toddler size hat for the baby shower I went to on Sunday. And I got to the crown decreases and then I realized I couldn't find my other needle. It's a US size 6, which is a 4mm needle. I think I said it wrong on last week's podcast. But I will put a picture of the hat here that I worked on, just so you have a frame of reference. It's in my Wig and Tree colorway, and it was just a 12 to 18 month size hat. Didn't finish it, it's still sitting. But anyway, so instead of that, I was at the yarn shop teaching, and I was like, well, I don't have my other needle, and I didn't want to buy another one. I was like, I'm eventually going to find this needle. I just don't have it right now. So I'm just going to cast on a crochet blanket because I'll finish that within a day and have that done for the baby shower. So this is the really poorly lit photo that I took on the blanket. They don't know if it's a boy or girl. They're not finding out until the baby is born. So I chose a more mustardy yellow, a paler, like more true yellow color, and then the light sandy brown. And it was crocheted corner to corner using an H hook. It's a worsted weight blanket, and I did the linen stitch. So you're just increasing on the outside edge as you go up from the corner, and then when you get to the middle part, you decrease on the edges as well. So in the end, you're doing the single crochets in between each single crochet across each row. When you're increasing, you're doing the single crochet into the first and the last single crochet stitches, like actually into the physical stitch. And then when you're decreasing, you're inserting your hook into the first single crochet and the second, and the space afterward, and then crocheting two together. So single crochet two together. So that's what I worked on, and it was done and it was well received, and I was very excited about it. My battery's gonna die, big surprise. So I'm gonna go charge that and I'll be right back. All right, so we are back. Hopefully I have enough juice in this battery to finish out the podcast before I have to charge it again. I didn't wanna wait too long because I'm on a very tight time schedule with the nap today. So yeah, the last thing we talked about, it's been a little while for me, but we talked about the blanket I finished for Sunday's baby shower. And I also talked about the hat that I didn't finish, and the shawl that I started, the sock I finished. Okay, so I don't have anything else in terms of the finished objects, crocheting or knitting things. I haven't done a ton this week. I only did what I showed you. Text messages, interruption, sorry. So let's get into dye work. So I don't have any new dyeing to show you today aside from what I did last week. You guys haven't seen yet the self-striping yarn that I did. But in terms of other skeins that are going to be going up this weekend, I'm not sure if I'll have an update this weekend, only because all my sock yarn is delayed until Friday. So I'm not going to get to dye anything until Friday, and I may get a chance to dye a bunch and put some in the shop Saturday, but you'll just have to keep an eye out on my Instagram. Again, I always keep my social media information below, and usually if I'm doing an update or I'm going to put some things in the shop, I usually announce it there first. So that's always the best way to get that information. Okay, so let's talk. Oh, acquisitions. Acquisitions, I only have one. So I had to replace my little Notions pouch for my crochet hooks. What I was using before was this black pencil case, just a vinyl pencil case that you get at Target or Staples or something. So I was in Target and I knew I had to get a replacement for my crochet hooks. This is where I keep all my crochet hooks. And we were getting some toiletries. I had to get some hand sanitizing wipes because Tucker thought it would be a great idea to stick his hands in the toilet when Stacey went to the potty when we got there. So I'm in the travel section and then I saw a bunch of these little tiny vinyl bags for like 89 cents. So I'll show you inside. There's just some scrappy yarn and crochet hooks. Literally everything that was in my little pencil case, I just took out and shoved in here, including some quarters. You can hear the change in there. But I needed something new. So if you're ever needing something for crochet hooks, these are the perfect size, perfect length for crochet hooks, as long as they're not big ergonomic hooks or anything. These are just plain metal hooks. I have all different sizes, but the length of this pouch is absolutely perfect for crochet hooks. So if you're ever in Target and you need to get something for your notions, check the travel section, because these little pouches are pretty durable and they're only 89 cents. I mean, you can't go wrong with this. And then also, I forgot to mention my favorite last week. So in the beginning of the podcast, I talked and I said, I'm going to tell you about one of my favorite things. So I never showed it because interruptions. But this is what I was going to show you. So this lives in my pocket. This is my Love and Leche Anywhere Balm. This is the citrus rose scent. And I got this in my local yarn shop. You can see it's pretty well used. There's a very significant amount gone from the pan. But I use this as a lip balm in the winter. Well, all year, because I'm addicted to lip balm. Isn't everybody addicted to lip balm? But, ooh, it's so good. But this is a really great balm. You can use it on your hands if you get dry hands when you're knitting. This is the information, so loveandleche.com. Check your local yarn shop too and see if they carry these, but they come in these tiny little travel size, which I find very useful and very awesome for lip balm. But they also have like lotion bars that you can actually remove from the tin, so they're larger tins, probably this big, and they come in all different scents. This happens to be my favorite scent. I'm not a scent person per se. I'm not really into having lots of different scented things. Most of the time I'm just okay with unscented lotions and unscented like face products and things like that, but for my lip balm I like to have a little bit of a scent, and this was the most pleasant, not overpowering, very citrus, floral all at the same time, and it smells really good. So that was the favorite I didn't talk about last week, for anybody who picked up on that. But I did want to show you the bag again. So I am doing a collaboration with Lana Sunshine and Bubblegum, and if you've not seen her podcast, you should definitely go check out her channel. She is also a crocheter and she's a knitter too, and she does sew project bags just, you know, for her own pleasure and also to sell on her Etsy shop from time to time. And we did a collaboration over the winter time where she made these little bags that were this size, but they had hot cocoa on them, and I did a peppermint swirl yarn that would micro stripe up the sock to go with the bags. So this time we did this collaboration. She just sent me these bags last week for this round. It was a fabric we picked together, and it's just got feathers on it, these really cool colors. And this is the yarn that I dyed to go with it. So, hello. So I wanted to pull on these colors, and this color, a little darker. It's kind of a cross between these two, this green and this blue, for the mid-tone blue. But this yarn is what will be going with the kits, and I can show it to you skeined up. Sorry, if I blew out your ears. I have a couple skeined up. I know this one looks redder, but it's just the way that the yarn is tensioned and wrapped around itself. But these are the same proportions, same colors. So you can see there's like a deeper blue, a mid-tone blue, and then this kind of strawberry red, fiery red type color. It's got a nice orange shift to it, which matches the bags pretty well. And I'll kind of show you the skeins. So I have a bunch of these not skeined up, but you can see the difference between the two dye lots. So one dye lot, the blue, the darker blue came out slightly darker. Let's see if I can find it. Here we go. So you can see, so I use the same formula of dye. I'm not quite sure why, but well, maybe this isn't the one. It's so hard to tell. Okay. I had two dye lots of 5 skeins a piece that I dyed last week. You can see it here. So this came out a little bit deeper than this. But it's the same color, it's just this came out slightly deeper. I don't know if it was because of the order in which I added dye to the pan, because these are all custom tones, or just the way that the heat was, if it was hotter so it struck faster, or took a little extra time, or I had more water in the pan, who knows. But they're very, very beautiful. So these are what is coming into the shop. Probably, I don't want to give a date, because I'm not sure when I'll be able to get all these reskeined, but I want to say in the next few weeks, probably come April 1st, they will definitely be available. I would say by April 1st at the latest, I should be able to get the rest dyed and then reskeining, which is a long process, but I'll get them reskeined. So yeah, this is the color. Again, it's very cool. It's a 3-stripe self-striping yarn. So it's 2 to 3 rows each. They're short stripes. 2 to 3 rows each of each color, and they go very well with the bag. So those will be offered. The bag, we have feather stitch markers that Lynn's sister Kira made. Hi Kira. So she made those. We have those set aside. We have some tea and goodies that are going in the bag, as well as the yarn. And then probably I think I'm gonna do an undyed mini skein. So having a nice creamy heels, toes, and cuffs with this, I think would look really nice to go with the bag. So that's it. That's all I really have for you guys today. I do have some skeins left in the shop. I've had quite a few orders this week. My little yarn pile is down to just about 1 cubby full of yarn. I have to do, again, I have to do some dyeing, but I can't do it without my yarn. So if you have any suggestions, so, oh, I did have a question. All right. Let's rewind. I did have a question in the Ask Me Anything thread in my Ravelry group. If you don't know, I do have a Ravelry group. I'm not super active on Ravelry, but I do go over there once a day, twice a day to read comments and to check out anybody who's new, who's introduced themselves, to learn a little bit more about you guys. I do go over there. but I do have a thread in the Ravelry group that's an Ask Me Anything thread or an Ask a Dyer thread. So if you have questions for me, I know a lot of the topics on my channel are usually things that I'm learning along the way as I'm growing my yarn dyeing business, and also, you know, just even dyeing for fun and learning the mechanisms of dyeing and the things that all go in that realm. But somebody asked me a question about knitting and I wanted to address it here. So I can't remember the user. I saw the question and I did respond in the group, but she asked if I had a tutorial for how I knit, because she's also a crocheter and she's going to knit. And so what I'll do is I'll link the video up here in the corner box, in the little eye. So if you click that, sometimes I'll put videos up there that are referenced in the podcast, but I'll link the tutorial. So it's called the Knitting Technique for Crocheters, I think I called it, and it's a Norwegian, it's a continental knit, which is just a pick knit with holding your yarn in your left hand. Well, I guess if you're looking at me, I don't know which way, it's backwards. And I do a Norwegian purl where I keep the yarn behind my work and I insert my needle behind my yarn through my stitch up and around to hook the yarn and then back through. And it's a very natural feel for me as a crocheter. I never liked moving my yarn to the front of my work because I've been crocheting for so long that it's hard to get out of that. And I had no idea this purling method existed. There was only one video on YouTube that I had found that had this type of purl, because when you're looking for new techniques, you never know what the techniques are called. You're just like, crocheter, learning to knit, and purling. And then you get up with whatever videos that people have tagged with those terms. And so a lot of the older videos that are on YouTube that have been on there a while that may show Norwegian purling may not associate that type of purling with a technique that works well for crocheters. So I wanted to put a video up to be clear that this technique of purling exists, because I had only found one video. It said speed purling and it showed that technique. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is changing my life. But I wanted to make sure that it was associated with crocheters who are learning to knit, because most crocheters don't feel comfortable constantly moving their yarn back and forth, back and forth. Now, this technique doesn't have you move your yarn, but you do have to be aware of where your yarn is if you're doing textured stitches, alternating knits and purls, like whether your yarn needs to be on the front or the back of your work. You have to work around all of that when you're doing other types of stitches, but learning a Norwegian purl is actually really helpful, and it might be a little bit more intuitive for you if you're like me, where you don't like to move your yarn. Then you can just do a purl without moving your yarn. You don't have to. So anyway, tangent done. Okay, and then the other thing was, if you had any questions for me, you can always put them in the thread. You can always ask me on Instagram, on Etsy. I do have a contact me box on my website, so if you do have questions about colorways or suggestions about things that you'd like to see in the shop, you're very much welcome to use any of those methods to contact me. Instagram is probably not the best way to contact me, only because I miss a lot of the tags or comments that come and go, because sometimes I get inundated with them all at once. So best way to contact me is usually through Etsy, or you can contact me via email, or the message box on my website goes to my email, so you'll get a more timely response that way. But anything related to open orders should always go through Etsy. Please don't email me otherwise. You know, if something is coming to you from me through Etsy, then please contact me through Etsy so I can keep all that together. Anyway, so I do take suggestions very seriously. I can't read everyone's mind of what you guys like to see, so I always like to see feedback and comments, whether here on YouTube or on Instagram photos, or again messages to me through Etsy or my website, because then I know what you guys are kind of looking for, because otherwise I'm just sitting here going, what do I feel like dyeing today? And I just pick a color to dye, or I pick a new color to dye, and I just kind of go about it that way. So if there's ever a color that you're in need and you want to see it pop up in the shop that week, definitely earbird me, let me know, tag me, message me. I'm always very much open to those suggestions, because it lets me help you guys get the yarn that you want. For those who are interested in purchasing yarn, again, you don't have to, but if you're interested in seeing other colors, even if you just like looking at yarn and you want to see some colors come up on the podcast, or you want to see how things are done, I'm very, very much entertaining questions at any point. So I also apologize for the crazy light and me talking a million miles an hour, because I don't know when my camera's gonna die. Sorry. There actually is an option that you can watch things on a slower speed, so then you'll see me talking like this on the podcast. If I'm talking too quickly, you can make it go slower in the button below. Okay, I'm weird. Okay. That's enough, Kayleen. Stop being weird. Okay, so that's all I really had for you guys today. I hope you all have a wonderful week. Again, I'm probably not gonna have too much of a shop update this week because my yarn is delayed, but those kits that I have going on with Lynn are actually getting done, and they should be done hopefully in the next couple of weeks, so I can put them up in the shop and she can put them up in her shop and get them to you. And that's again, welcome to everyone who's new. I'm sorry I'm weird, I'm a little weird, but I like to have a little fun with this, and yeah, I'm just weird, just ignore me. Anyway, have a wonderful week. Spread happiness, love, positivity, be wonderful, love you guys. I will see you next time. Bye.